known as braid, this piece of linen underwear that I've got. Extended jumper almost of this padded material. And it slips on over the head, like so. That's better already. A nice thick quilted body armor. Henry II, the king of this time, decreed that every free man in England should own such a garment for defence of the realm. Poorer people had to make do with straw or horsehair, but in my case, as I said to you, many layers of felt, wool and linen sewn into tubes. It's excellent body armour in its own right, it really is. Particularly good for absorbing any kind of impact blow against the body from maces and clubs and the like. But in my case, I'm going to go one further. This isn't quite enough for me, I'm afraid, because I, after all, am a knight. And so, I'm about to be protected with my main piece of body armour. This, ladies and gentlemen, predates the time of plate armour. This is as good as it gets. This is all handmade by a specialist armourer. It took many, many months to make. And so it was very expensive. We know from illustrations, this is exactly how it was put on. The knight would kneel, two squires would assist in putting it on over the shoulders. You see that it does fall nicely over the body and sinks like a big heavy sack across said body. So I'm just going to stand upright and give it a shake. Now you can see that all the armour here is split right up the middle. You might think, well, I know where I'm going to hit him. But thankfully, that doesn't come to pass. The reason it's split is because I need to mount the horse. Once I'm on the horse, my destrier, my war horse, had a saddle, which was very particular of the time, with a very high pommel and a very high canter at the back. It's like I'm sat in an armchair. You would not see any of this at all. All you'll see bearing down upon you is a fully armed man. So I don't care about this bit here, it's well protected by the horse itself. Next up, the arming cap goes on. Now you'll notice before this came on, I was wearing a linen headpiece, a coif on my head. It was considered polite, ladies and gentlemen, to always have your head covered. It's only recently that men go out with their heads uncovered. Peasant scum, like him for example, coming out with their heads being covered. So at all times I would have had my head covered, much more so of course, because don't forget, I am not just a warrior, I'm a monk as well. So, the arming cap goes on of the same padded material, and then over it, the coif of mail on thigh goes on over the top as well. It is all extremely uncomfortable and pleasant. So now you can see I am armed, to use the French expression, le cap à pied in mail. In other words, I'm armed from head to toe in mail armour. We're not finished yet, not by a long stretch. But you can see now I'm extremely well protected. And the questions are often asked, is this stuff effective? And the answer is, yes, it is. A crossbow at short range, a longbow with a bodkin point at short range, might punch a hole in this. But to give you an idea, at this very crusade that these men from Wales went off to, chroniclers on both sides talked about the Frankish knights, the Western knights, riding around the battlefield looking like porcupines, with any number of arrows sticking out of them, completely unhurt. And equally, from battles of the time, for example the Battle of Lincoln in 1217, we know that over 2,000 knights took the field, and of all that number, only two died. One of whom, so going over my armour is no surcoat for me, I'm afraid, but a monk's robe, a capa plaza as it's known, a black woolen hooded robe. Think about this, ladies and gentlemen, my main area to fight is the Middle East. The campaigning season in the Middle East is in the summer. I get to wear all of this and that and fight in summer. Now tell me I'm not an idiot. So the cap and plaza goes on over my head. You'll notice mine is of black wool. A very, very expensive colour to produce. But it's because the Hospitallers followed the rule of Augustine, Saint Augustine. Different orders of monks had different colours to distinguish them. In the case of the Hospitallers, black was the way forward. But unlike any other normal monk, as it were, I'm distinguished by the cross on my breast. Originally, this was a simple Latin cross, such as that worn by my colleague, the standard bearer, the gonfanier at the back there. However, by the late 12th century, the time that this crusade was being preached, we know that the kings of England and France met and for the first time decreed that their armies would be identifiable by the colour cross they wore. The French would wear a red cross. The English and Angevin armies would wear a white cross. And so we're pretty certain that it's from this time the Hospitallers started to split their cross into 8 points to distinguish them from the other crusaders. And it's this very same cross that you'll see that in their later history that became known as the Knights of Malta, and you see this splaying out into the Maltese cross. And long after their military function finished, in the 18th century, it was revived once more. You'll know them today as St. John's Ambulance. We are the very same people. Obviously, my function is somewhat different. But first and foremost, the Hospitallers were always a medical order. Tying off my kappa around my waist, like any monk, the cincha, the simple rope belt, finished at one end with 3 knots representing the Holy Trinity. So far, so good. Here am I dressed as a warrior monk. I'm fully armoured. I'm not yet armed. So my squires are now going to bring forward for me my sword belt and a dagger, which is going to be used not just to arm me, but also to start to relieve some of this downward pressure of the male armour through my body. At the moment, from the top of the hauberk right down through my legs, it's all just forcing down through the floor. And so they're going to tie this off extremely tightly. Keep going. Extremely tightly. To start to take some of that weight onto my waist instead of dragging down through my legs. And with that in place, we're nearly there. You can see I have a dagger. I haven't got room to swing my sword, but my primary sidearm is broadsword. And I said to you before, this was bestowed upon me when I was knighted at around the age of 20. The sword then, ladies and gentlemen, and you'll find lots of examples in our camp, a very simple but very effective weapon. This is in effect a large two-edged knife made from one large piece of tempered steel right down through the handle. Now mine is kept blunt for safety reasons, but highly sharpened. And the idea is that this part here, the pommel, acts as a counterweight to the blade. So I should be able to swing this all day long without my arm getting tired. The quillons here protect my hand. Nice movers up there, sir. Nice move. To protect the hand in one go. Let's get rid of another myth for you. The groove down the middle here, the fuller. People say, was that for bloodletting? No, nothing of the sort. In fact, by removing weight from the blade, of course, it keeps it in the handle, better for me. And it also is easier to extract from someone's body. Less suction. How nice is that? I would have been highly trained in this from a very young age. Please do not think that knights were crude bludgeoners, nothing of the sort. Later on this afternoon, my colleagues will be demonstrating some of the arms and armour actually in action. And hopefully, you'll see some of the finesse that comes into that. Now we are nearly done, just a couple more pieces to go. My squire is about to strap my shield on my arm. The shield, you'll see, is made from planks of lime, which are warped and shaped so that they curve across the body. You can see how it's strapped onto my arm. And yes, indeed, this is of wood. Another myth dispelled for you. Shields were never metal, I'm afraid, except in Hollywood. The shape of it, this long teardrop shape, is exactly the same as you'd see in the Bayeux tapestry around 120 years earlier. In my case, The only real difference is that mine hasn't got a central boss of metal. But this was a time when shield technology was changing very rapidly. And again, later on, my colleagues will show you some of the different shapes of shield that were started to come to play in the 12th century. But in my case, this kite shield serves me extremely well, both to protect my entire body, and also when I'm on horseback, to flip back and protect my horse's flank, if that's what's required. Mine, of course, black with the white split cross, the cross forme of my order to identify me as well. From you there, just a few pieces to go. In a few minutes' time, my squires are going to clip this piece of mail across my face. It's called a vent tail, to completely protect my face. They will then put my helm on my head. Again, helmet technology is changing very rapidly at this time. Most helms were of the type worn by the standard bearer at the back there. Some form of conical helm or similar, or flat helm with some kind of nozzle or nose bar to the front, sometimes with a faceplate as well. But we know from the second seal of Richard the Lionheart on his way back from Crusade that helmets exactly like this weren't really worn. And they were worn by men such as myself. And like other knights, I, in my advanced years, will be leading a troop of my own men, known as a conroi, 10 to 20 men who have drilled together so that we can maneuver in perfect formation, rather like, say, the Lipizzaner horses, for example. And I'll be front and centre in that group of men. So I won't care what's to the left or the right or behind me, because I know it's my fellow men. As such, I can afford to protect my face fully. I don't care that I've got very, very limited vision. I'll be very, very well protected, particularly against arrows to the face, which, believe you me, hurts. So the helmet will go on, and they'll then pass me my lance, which is a spear. Mine would originally have been around 10 foot in length, and in this case, as you can see, mine ends with a pennant. This is the cross of St. John, the white cross on the red background. And it's that flag that my conroi would be following as we maneuver around the battlefield. So we'll get that done for you now. The vent tail gets clipped up, my voice will become muffled. There's the vent tail clipped up. Like so, you see now there's only one eye on this flag. Now to protect me further, the helm goes on. The lance comes to my head, and ladies and gentlemen, I give you a knight of Spiffler from 1188! Now, if you have any questions, ladies and gentlemen, we'll be delighted to take those. Our camp is on the far side over there. We are going to do a demonstration of arms, armor, and combat later on this afternoon. Meanwhile, thank you so much for your attention. We are the Knights of Spiffler of Warwickshire, and please a round of applause for my colleagues.